Turning green and the leaves are still, it's shouting that Jesus is alive. Amen. I am so glad that we are in the Easter season. This is my favorite time of the year, and I am so glad that you are here today with us, excited about what God's going to do this morning. It's great to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. So glad to see you this morning. We're glad to have guests with us. Got to meet a few of you. Thank you for joining with us. We're glad you're here with us today. Hope you'll sing with us, pray with us, and study God's word with us. We really are honored to have you with us today. And we do have a card in the pew that we'd like for you to fill out. It's orange looking. If you get that and fill that out. And then after the service, the pastors will be over here in the rotunda. We'd like to meet you personally. And so if you would come by, we got a small gift we want to give to you. We're just glad you're with us. And if you're with us online today, thank you for joining us. We're glad you're with us as well. A couple of things. We're beginning our Easter series. We're beginning it today. It's called My Easter Story. And so I'm really looking forward to it. And I hope you'll be here for every one of our services. And then Passion Week, we have a speed painter. Have y'all ever seen a speed painter paint one of those things and tell a story? We'll be doing that on Passion Week Wednesday night. And then we'll do the Living Lord's Supper on Thursday night. And then on Friday, the choir is going to do their big musical called My Easter Story. And so I hope you'll come and be a part of it, because Passion Week is a special week for all Christians. Amen. And it's a time when we reflect and we remember what Christ did for us. This afternoon, we're having Friends University, a new member class. If you want to learn more about our church, this is what you need to come to. So we'll be in the parlor in the gym, and we'll have a meal together. And so sign up and come be a part of that. And then we'll also be offering the second class, which is how to have a quiet time. So we invite you to come be a part of that as well. Well, it's also Easter time, and that also means we need some eggs for the kids. So if you would help us get eggs and gather them up and put candy in them, we're going to have an Easter egg on that Wednesday night for the kids as well. All right? So this morning, we're going to be learning about my Easter story, and this morning we're going to learn about Israel's Easter story and how it looked like that nation was going to go completely be destroyed, and God has saved it again and again and again. And this morning we're going to learn about that. So I'm glad you're here, because we all need hope. Amen. Things don't look very good, do they? But there is a hope that we as Christians have. All right, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. And this is a time of prayer. The Lord said that His house would be a house of prayer. And so if you would, right now, where you're at, under your breath, would you just begin to pray? And first of all, would you thank God for who He is, that He is Almighty God? And just like we sing these songs and we sing out, pray. Pray like that this morning. Pray that, God, You're a great and almighty God. And then would you thank God that He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross that we could have everlasting life? And would you thank the Lord this morning for Easter, that Jesus rose from the dead and gave us the victory? And I want you to pray specifically this morning for yourself and for your Easter story. What is your Easter story? Do you have an Easter story? And will you share that Easter story this season with others? Father, this morning, it is indeed a great joy and a privilege to be in your house. We see the trees starting to turn green, the grass, and it's all just shouting that You are alive, that You came back from the dead, You rose again. And this springtime just reminds us, God, of how You can take something that looks so dead and bring it back to life. And God, thank You that You have given us eternal life. If there's someone here this morning and they do not have eternal life, I pray that today would be their day, that they would receive You as their personal Savior. God, speak to us today, because we live in a time when hope seems to be very, very low, and we need hope. And I pray this morning that Your Holy Spirit would just breathe into us life and fullness and hope. And so, God, do a work that only You can do in this service with us this morning. We ask all this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. All right, let's sing to the Lord.
My great Redeemer's voice. Hallelujah.
I fix my eyes on Christ, my King.
is in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Found, but now.
songs that we get to sing. Amen. So that last song that we just sang, our very own worship pastor Nathan and Ron wrote that song. Isn't it beautiful? And a powerful song about God's grace and hope. So I appreciate what the Holy Spirit is doing in our music ministry. Amen. Beautiful. Well, a few years ago, my wife and along with my roommate, my college roommate, Shelby, and his wife, Janet, we made a trip to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and we had the opportunity to go to Gettysburg and see all that where the Civil War, one of the great battles of the Civil War was fought. And there's a lot of ground to cover there, and so Janet, Shelby's wife, had the great idea that we could ride these segways, and we didn't kill each other, you know, but we had a lot of fun riding those things, and we were having fun riding through those, and they have headphones that you put on, and they give you information, historical information about the battles and things like that, and as we was riding them, we came up to this one place, and it's kind of elevated, kind of like you're on a hill, and you look down, and you see this large field, and then you hear in your headphones, this is where 50,000 men died. And I'm telling you, it just, you know, we had been goofing off and laughing, but suddenly our countenance changed as we tried to imagine and try to take that whole scene in. I asked the others what they felt when we were there, and Janet says, she said, no words. Kim said she felt overwhelmed. And Shelby said he just thought of the how sad of for all of that loss and for me, I just wanted to keep going. I didn't want to stay there. I just wanted us to keep moving on because it was such a overwhelming feeling that you have when you're there. You know, as a pastor, I go to cemeteries to speak words of comfort to those who are about to bury their loved ones. And sometimes someone will say to me, well, Pastor, I guess you're used to this by now. But you don't ever get used to it. Matter of fact, when you've been at the same church with the same people for 29 years, I'm telling you, it gets harder. It gets heavier. You feel the weight of it. Recently, my daughter started working at Dallas Baptist University, and near the university is the Dallas-Fort Worth National Cemetery. I don't know if you've ever been to a national cemetery, but it's just row after row after row of these crosses where servicemen and women are buried. Our theme for Easter this year is My Easter Story, and the Bible teaches us that our Easter story is about hope. And we have sung about hope this morning. So what I want us to do this morning, I want us to go to the Old Testament. We're going to go to Ezekiel chapter 37. So if you'll take your Bibles and be turning there. But what I want to tell you before we get there is that God gave Ezekiel a vision that is worse than a Civil War battlefield. It is worse than a national cemetery. And I would even say that it's worse than Hitler's Auschwitz. I would say that it's worse than Hiroshima after Truman dropped the bomb. So I want you to feel, I want you to try to understand what's going on here and to set you up for what we're getting ready to read. The valley before Ezekiel was not filled with nice headstones or crosses, but rather it was a sea of scattered, dry, disconnected bones that had been there for a while, and they were scorched by the sun. And Ezekiel, when he saw this grisly scene, I'm sure he shuddered, not because he was a priest and forbidden to touch a human corpse, but because according to God's holy law, bodies that have not been buried and that had been exposed like this is a sign that they had fallen under God's curse. And so this scene that he views is a gruesome, ugly, pitiful scene, and it is a vision and a picture of the most hopeless situation that a person, a family, a church, a state, or a nation could ever encounter. Now, I wonder, have you ever been in a place where you felt absolutely hopeless? like there was nothing that could be done, that there was nothing that could change this, there was nothing that can make this better. What happened here? Was it a battle? Was it a massacre? Was it a natural disaster? Some terrible plague maybe that wiped out an entire nation? So many bones, so much death. And so God has painted a picture, a vision that he has given to Ezekiel because he wanted to shake Ezekiel to his bones. And I wonder this morning, is there anything that God could say or do that would shake you to your bones? When is the last time that you felt chills go up your spine because you saw something so horrible, so terrible, that it actually shook you? That's the picture, that's the vision that he is wanting us to have here this morning. It's the feeling of no words, overwhelm, terrible loss, and I don't even want to stay around this, it's so bad. You see, this vision that he gives to Ezekiel, it's irreversible, it's irretrievable, it's irredeemable, it's unrecoverable, it's unrepairable, it's beyond hope. And then in this vision, Ezekiel is walking around in the bones. Imagine how weird that would be. So, you know, he's walking and these bones are all around him. And there's a head over there and a leg over there. And they're just scattered all around him. And then God comes to him in this vision. And of all the things that God could say or God could ask, God asked the most far-fetched question and he asked this prophet, he says, can these bones live again? Why would he ask him such a question like these? But the question he's asking, is there any hope? Would you stand this morning? We're going to read the Holy Scriptures. And oh, this is a great passage. Beginning with verse 1, it says, the hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. And then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed, they were very dry. And he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord God, you know. Again, he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise. And suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over. But there was no breath in them. Also, he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. And so I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived, and they stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. And then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They indeed say, our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your grave and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves. I will put my spirit in you and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, says the Lord. Thank you. May be seated. May God add the blessing to the reading of his word. So how did we get here? How do we get to this valley of dry bones? How did God's people get to such a place? And sometimes I think we need to ask ourselves, how did we get in the place we are when we feel so very hopeless? Well, in verses 1 through 10, we have the vision. And it is a vision that God gave to Ezekiel. And then in verses 11 through 14, we have the interpretation of what this vision actually meant. So you see, many, many years ago, God had promised Abraham that Abraham and all of his descendants, if they would worship him alone and follow his commands, that he would give them the promised land that today you and I call Israel. And he would bless them. And one of the blessings that he would give them is that the Messiah would come from this great nation that we call Israel. And so this was God's promise, but God also warned Israel that if they did not worship the one true God, if they brought in other gods, or that he would not bless them and he would take them out of the land. And that they would be under his curse and under his judgment. So over the years and the centuries, there were good times when Israel followed God and obeyed, like during when King David was king. I mean, that was some of the glory years and on into Solomon's reign. But after Solomon's reign, Israel began to worship other gods and they rebelled against following his commands. And so God sent prophets to warn them and say, you need to turn back to God. You need to turn back to God. And God even used Jeremiah to tell them, listen, if you don't turn back, you're going to go into captivity for 70 years. But the people didn't believe. And so God allowed King Nebuchadnezzar, the great king of Babylon, to send an army to Jerusalem. And he takes over the city and over Judah. And he removes Israel king and he sets up his own puppet king to follow him. And then he takes about 11,000 Jews, most of them young, from the priest and from the royal, from royal families, and he brings them to Babylon. People like Daniel, Meshach, Abednego, and these Shadrach, these guys, and you're probably familiar with them from the Bible stories of how Daniel was in the lion's den, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were put in the fiery furnace. You probably remember. Now, while this was bad, it seemed like there's still hope. There's still a little bit of hope, possibly, that maybe the Jews would repent and turn back to God, but no. They continued to live in sin. They continued to bring in other idols. Now, can you even imagine? We love this building that God has given us. Amen. We are so thankful for this building. And this building has been set aside. It is sacred because this is for the worship of Jesus Christ, our God alone. Amen. So can you imagine us allowing someone else to come in here and to worship another God in here? That would be horrible, wouldn't it? We wouldn't allow that. That's what the Jews did. They allowed some idols to be brought into the very temple where they were supposed to be worshiping God alone. And so God prompts Nebuchadnezzar to send another army back. And he goes back and he brings back another group. And in this group is this priest and this young prophet named Ezekiel. And it looks like hope has just gone even lower and lower and lower. And in chapters 1 through 24 of the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel pleads with God's people to please put away your false gods and to worship God alone and follow his commands. But they still refuse. And God says they are a stubborn, stiff-necked people who refuse to repent. And so King Nebuchadnezzar, a third time, sends an army back to Jerusalem and totally ransacks the whole place, burns the city down, destroys the temple, even plows up the foundation. I mean, he literally destroyed the place. And he brings back a few more Jews, but the remaining people who were there were killed. It was terrible. Jerusalem is desolate. It's dead. It looks so bad. No one would want to live there because all hope is gone. Now, I want you to understand the picture here, because King Nebuchadnezzar's intent was for Israel to lose her identity and to just assimilate into Babylon culture, and Israel would be no more. It would just be extinct. And that's what happened to many of the other nations that King Nebuchadnezzar conquered. And so for all practical purposes, this is the extinction of Israel. Like the dinosaurs, there's only bones and skeletons left that give any indication that they still exist or that they ever existed. And so that's when he gives us this interpretation. And look at verse 11 with me again. He says, "Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. And they indeed say, our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off.'" In other words, they understand the interpretation is here, we're gone. It's over for Israel. It's done. We feel like this is finished. Anyone been to a gas station lately? Feel like you've been robbed, don't you? I mean, it's discouraging, isn't it? I believe that we're living in a time when hope is really going down, isn't it? It's very discouraging what we see. For over 2 years, world leaders, the media, they have just been promoting and telling us all about this fear and all these things, and we've just been hearing it over and over. And I've never seen fear and hopelessness as low as it's ever been. Personal stress, mental breakdowns, and they tell us that suicide's at our all-time high, not just here in America, but around the world. And the bad news is they're telling us it's not going to get better, that inflation is going to continue to rise, and the whole world is on the edge wondering, are we fixing to go into World War III? Is it going to happen? And maybe you came here today and you've got problems and you've got worries and situations, and you wonder, am I going to make it through this? Things look really, really bad. And I say to you this morning, that's why we have Easter. That's the reason that as Christians, we have real hope. And that's what we want to look at this morning. Can these bones live? Is there any hope? And the answer is, if it's up to us, no. We cannot breathe money into our bank accounts, love into our marriages, health into our bodies, obedience into our children, passion into our churches, morality into our society, any more than Ezekiel could breathe life into those dead bones. But Ezekiel teaches us what we must do. His answer, when I first read his answer and first started studying this, I didn't really understand it. Oh, Lord, you know. The Hebrew is a little bit more expressive when you look at the words, because he's really saying, oh, sovereign, all-knowing Lord, you alone know. And what he's saying here is, God, I'm putting the ball back in your court. I'm going to look to you, God, and not myself. I'm looking to you, God. And so God then gives him a response and gives him a solution. And he commanded Ezekiel, preach, prophesy. God commanded him to preach to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. So this morning, I want to give you three things that we need to be doing, that we need to understand this morning, if we're really going to live in this world that is so hopeless, if we're going to live with hope. And the first thing is, when all hope is gone, hear the word of the Lord. The most important thing that we can do if we want to have hope is to come back to this word and to hear the word of the Lord. And now, have you ever had someone make a suggestion and you're like, that's not going to work. That's not going to work. You know, but that's what you want to do. We'll try it. In John chapter 21, after the crucifixion, Peter had denied the Lord three times. So he was kind of ashamed of himself. And the Lord has risen. He's seen the Lord. But Peter decides he's going back to his old job, so he goes and he's fishing. He has fished all night and not caught a thing. I mean, not even a minnow. He's just had nothing. And so he's fished all night. He's coming in. He's fixing to clean his nets and put everything up. And he hears a voice from the beach that says, "Did you catch anything?" And it's the Lord's voice. It's Jesus. And he says, "No." He says, "Well, I want you to launch out and I want you to cast the net on the right side." Peter's like, I'm an experienced fisherman. And you want me to, I fished all night. There's not anything out there. It's not going to happen. You know, I'm sure all this is going through his mind. But he says, "Nevertheless, at your word, I will drop my nets." And if you remember the story, he drops them down and the nets become so full that he has to get help to pull it in. I mean, they're just busting at the seams. He has caught so many fish. You know, the world today scoffs at the solution that God is giving us here. And I'm afraid even many Christians today doubt its power. But God commanded him to prophesy, to preach to dry, dead bones. And they probably looked, I mean, that probably seemed like a really foolish act. What could preaching and hearing the word of the Lord do to dead, dry bones? Years later, the Apostle Paul would acknowledge that the message of the cross, God's plan of Jesus dying on the cross to pray for our sins, was foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. There is something mighty and special about God's word and God's preaching. And we need to get back to preaching and hearing the word of God because this is where real hope comes from. John Maxwell said, "Where there is no hope in the future, there is no power in the present." And so if you feel defeated and hopeless, it's because you're not in the word of God and you're not hearing the word of God, and that's what we need to do. Now, how strange it must have felt for Ezekiel to preach to dry, dead bones. You know, when COVID first started and I had to preach just to a camera, it was horrible because those cameras never say amen. They never say hallelujah. They don't do anything. And I'm used to having live people in front of me. And it was tough. But can you imagine trying to preach to dead, dry bones? I mean, what was he going to say? You guys look good today. No. I guess he could have said, "Well, I look better than y'all today. I look better than my audience. No doubt about that today." So what a challenge it must have been for him to have to do that. Now, have you ever had that battle on Sunday morning that you didn't feel like going to church to hear the word of God? You're tired, you're worn out, you feel down, but you do it anyway. And when you leave, what happens? God does something, doesn't he? There's something about coming together and hearing the word of God that changes and transforms people's life. And I can't explain it, and I don't think anyone really can, other than that we know it's the word of God and the spirit of God. So when are we going to learn that preaching and hearing the word of God is not optional, it's not optional. Our very spiritual life depends on it. We need it. We need it desperately, especially in these times in which we live, because it gives us real hope. It works because it's of God, and God is love, and God is life. Now, I want you to notice, next of all, when lies surround you, hear the word of truth. Now, I want to share something with you that's kind of hard for me to share with you, but when we went through this COVID-19 things, one of the hardest things, one of the most disappointing things for me was all my life I have had very high respect and regard for medical and science professionals like Dr. Fauci. Honestly, I have. And when they would say, "This is a science," I just believed them. I did. I was taught to do that, and I just went, but since COVID-19, it's opened my eyes, and I'm afraid a lot of things have been corrupted by politics and money, hasn't it? And so now we don't know who we can trust. And we hear these different stories, sometimes coming from the very same person. We're like, well, what is true and what is not true? And that makes me sad because I want to trust them. Well, Israel had made some really bad decisions, and here is why. And because they believed lies. They were being taught lies, and they were telling lies, and they were coming up with stories, and they were going to these false idols and things, and they have what the Bible calls strongholds in their lives. And these strongholds were keeping them hostage to sin, to evil, and to wickedness, and to depression, and to discouragement. Did you know that every stronghold in your life is held there by a lie that you believe? It's held by a lie that you are believing and that you're holding on to. And there is only one thing that can set you free, and that is the truth. The truth, and God's word is true. And so I would ask you this morning, where does Satan have a hook in you? Where in your life does Satan have a stronghold in your life? Do you worry? Do you have anxiety? That's a stronghold in your life. Maybe cheating when no one's looking. Is it that temper, that anger? Maybe you have a problem with cussing. Are you negative? Are you critical? Is it gossiping? Is it lying? Is it slandering? Is it prejudice? Being judgmental? Is it doubting? I don't know what is it. Maybe I didn't name it. But is there a stronghold in your life and you're wondering, why can't I get over this? Why can't I get past this? Why can't I let this go? Why does this keep pulling me down? The Apostle Paul says a stronghold is a wrong belief somewhere that we are believing that is in our mind and in our heart. Listen to what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Wow, we need the word of God now more than ever, amen? Because we're being saturated with lies from everywhere. And our hope is to hear the truth of God's word. Now listen to what the writer of Hebrews says when he describes the power of God's word in Hebrews 4:12. He says, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Wow. The Bible can do that. The word of God can go, do, discern in your heart and mind like nothing else. And this is why biblical preaching and teaching and reading God's word and sharing God's word is so important. You see, you don't need my opinions. You need thus saith the Lord. And I don't know if you noticed when we were reading this passage in Ezekiel. Ezekiel is sharing God's word, and several times it says, thus saith the Lord. And he was saying, this is what God says. The Apostle Paul was coming near the end of his life, and he writes to this young pastor, and this is what he tells him in 2 Timothy 2 through 4. He says, preach the word, be ready in season, out of season, convince, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, their own identities that they want, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. In other words, just going to make stuff up, a fable. A fable is something that's not real. And folks, we're living in that time right now, aren't we? People get offended over the truth, and they demand and want us to believe a lie. Our president this week stood before our nation on national television, and he told a huge lie. He does not follow the science, and certainly not the word of God. You can outwardly see the difference between a man and a woman, amen? You can see the difference, can't you? It's obvious to all, even to a child. The science bears it out physically. But not only that, our scientists have looked and they have seen the DNA that is on the inside. They know a proven truth that all the surgeries and hormone treatments and whatever will not change a person's DNA. But because of their own desires, they turn away from the truth and they accept this made-up fable. And now, I ask you, is that really helping those people? Does it really help them? And what's worse, they want us to accept this fable and to play along with it like it's true. And if we don't, we're the ones who are considered evil and bad. Isn't this crazy? Christian, you're going to have to make up your mind. Are you going to mislead people to be accepted and to be politically correct? Or are you going to tell them the truth and probably be hated for it? To stand for the truth. But let me tell you something, what God is wanting us to see here. A person can never be saved or changed until they first hear the truth. Even if they don't like it, even if it upsets them, they need to hear the truth. They need to know that they are a sinner in need of a Savior. They cannot know they are a sinner until they hear the truth. And one of the primary callings of the church and every Christian is we don't pretend the dry bones don't exist. And we don't pretend that fables are real. We bear witness to all that is true, including its death and despair as taught in the Bible. People who are dead in trespasses and sin need to hear the truth. But praise God, we don't stay there. Because notice next, the third thing I want to give you this morning is when death seems final, hear the word of life. Of life. You know, it's strange that COVID-19 brings about acute respiratory distress syndrome. And that's very deadly. It can be very deadly, especially to particular segments. And the physical act of breathing consists of two phases. The first phase is called inspiration or inhaling. So in inspiration, think of God breathing into Adam. It's the same word when he breathed the breath of life and made him a living soul. So the Bible speaks as the Bible is God breathed. It is inspired. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16, it says, all scripture is inspired. And that word inspired there means God breathed. All scripture is God breathed by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. So we inhale, our diaphragms contract and move downward so that the space in our chest cavity increases. The lungs expand, air is pulled in, and oxygen flows to our blood. And then we have this second phase, phase two, which is called expiration or exhaling. It's when people, years ago when people would die of natural causes, they would say they expired. The breath went out of them. Under this second phase of breathing, carbon dioxide flows from the blood into the lungs, and then it's forced out when we exhale. Do you know the average person takes about 25,000 breaths per day? That's a lot of breathing, isn't it? 10 times in our passage, in this passage that you and I read, 10 times it uses the Hebrew word ruach. And it is translated spirit, breath, or wind. But it's the same Hebrew word, ruach. In Ezekiel's vision, he preaches the word and the bones hear the word of the Lord and there's this rattling that begins. Wouldn't that be eerie to be there and to hear that rattling? And it gets louder and louder and then pretty soon muscle begins to come on these bones and flesh. And now these bones have body, but they're not breathing. That's weird, isn't it? Look at verse 8 and 9. Again, it says, indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. Also, he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. Did you know that when you share the truth of God's word and you pray for the Holy Spirit to lead you, that God, the Holy Spirit, makes you greater than a spiritual ventilator? Breath, the breath of life. In the days of Ezekiel, Israel was breathing all the wrong things, the gods of Baal, the immorality of the pagans, greed, and every corrupt thing. It was only because they had become, and that was the reason they had become captives and slaves. And so they cried out to God, and here's what they said, our bones are dried up, our hope has perished, we are completely cut off. And we may not fully understand how the word of God and the spirit of God can give life. But Jesus testified, and listen to what he says in John 5:24. Most assuredly, you understand what most assuredly means? I mean, with everything that I believe, most assuredly, everything that I believe, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who has sent me and sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Wow, that is powerful. This is Israel's Easter story. They should have died. They should have become extinct as a nation. And have you ever thought, why are they still here? After all the people who've tried to get rid of Israel, you think about Hitler and the others, and they've tried to get rid of Israel over and over and over, but they can't seem to get rid of them. Did you know this very vision came to pass? God returns Israel. Ezra, we just studied the book of Ezra here on Sunday mornings, and God sends a remnant back. It's amazing, but did you know this is going to be fulfilled another time? When you read the book of Revelation, it talks about these four winds and it talks about these two prophets who are going to preach, and 144,000 Jews are going to rise up and they're going to begin to preach the gospel. They're going to believe in Jesus Christ. Life is going to come back to this nation that so many people have tried to kill. Israel's going to be restored, and the Bible says that they're going to reign with Christ for 1,000 years here upon the earth. And listen, I don't think it's too far away. The Lord's getting ready to come back. But listen, church, listen to what I'm fixing to say. There is no person too hard for God to save. There is no problem, no situation in your life that's going on that God cannot turn around. The Valley of Dry Bones is to teach us that there is no place too hard for God to revive. When Jesus died on the cross, it looked like all hope was gone. It looked like he was a failure. That was Friday, but then came Sunday. And his body began to breathe. Life came back in. And he arose from the dead. So how can we as Christians give up on hope? When Jesus paid for our sins, he paid for the sins of the world. And when the gospel is preached, the Spirit of God draws men, women, boys, and girls to Jesus Christ. My Easter story, your Easter story, is about hope where there seems to be no hope. And we need to put our hope in Jesus. And as we sang this morning, hope has a name, and his name is Jesus Christ. So if you have not received Jesus Christ as your Savior today, there's still hope for you. If you will believe, if you will come to Jesus Christ, you can be saved. Christian, don't stop sharing the word of God. You may have that person in your life that you want to see them come to Christ, and you think, man, there doesn't seem to be any hope for them. Or parents, maybe you have a rebellious child and you think there seems to be no hope for them. Don't stop hearing the word of the Lord. It infuses life into us that we so desperately need. Would you stand this morning? In just a few minutes, we're going to have a time of invitation, and we want to invite you this morning. You've heard the word of God. Now, what are you going to do with the word of God?
To be our thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving us and giving yourself for us. We thank you for the power of the Spirit that has raised you from the dead. And I pray that because of your resurrection and your Spirit, none of us are too far gone. And if we are hopeless now, there's always hope awaiting because of you. Thank you for, we can look forward to the blessed hope, which is the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And help us to ever keep that on the forefront of our mind as we go out into the world and as we minister to people and as we try to bring them into friendship with Jesus Christ. I pray your blessings upon everything that's been said and done today, that it would be to your honor and to your glory. And if there's anybody that is present that is lost, we pray that you would give your Spirit to them, to awaken them, to bring them to faith in Jesus. Help us to be faithful to you as we go out from this place. We thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right, we love you. We'll see you next week.